Thank you very much. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. One day, when you are out of town on a business trip, you wake up with a cough, muscle aches, chills, and a high fever. You do not know what it is. You start to panic, but you do know what action to take. You call a doctor. He conducts a physical exam, takes a history, administers lab tests, narrows down the possibilities. Within hours, he reaches a diagnosis of pneumonia and prescribes a course of treatment, including antibiotics. Soon you begin to respond, you relax, the crisis is over. Or, you are getting out of your car, you fall and break your leg. It's a disaster, but you remain calm because you can utter one sentence to your wife. Call the doctor. He proceeds to examine your leg for nerve and blood vessel injury. He takes x-rays, reduces the fracture, puts on a cast. The disaster has faded into a mere inconvenience, and you resume your normal life. Or your child comes home from school with a stabbing pain in the abdomen. There is only one hope. You call the doctor. He performs an appendectomy. The child recovers. We take all this completely for granted, as though modern drugs, modern hospitals, and modern doctors were facts of nature, which always had been there and which always will be there. Many people today take for granted not only the simpler kinds of medical intervention, such as the ones I just mentioned, but even the wonder cures and wonder treatments that the medical profession has painstakingly devised, like the latest radiation therapy for breast cancer, or the intricate delicacy of modern brain surgery, or such a breathtaking achievement as the artificial heart implants performed by Dr. William C. DeVries. Most of us expect that the doctors will go on accomplishing such feats routinely, steadily removing pain and thus enhancing the quality of our life while adding ever more years to its quantity. America's medical system is the envy of the globe. The rich from every other country, when they get sick, do not head for Moscow or Stockholm or even London anymore. They come here. And in some way, despite the many public complaints against the medical profession, we all know this fact. We know how good our doctors are and how much we depend on their knowledge, skill, and dedication. Suppose you had to go on a 6-month ocean voyage with no stops in port, with ample provisions and sailors, but with only one other profession represented on board in addition, and you could decide which it would be. Would you ask for your lawyer to come along? Your accountant? Your congressman? Would you dare even to ask for your favorite movie star? Or would you say, bring a doctor, what if something happens? The terror of having no answer to this question is precisely what the medical profession saves us from. I am not saying that all doctors are perfect. They are not. Or that they all have a good bedside manner. They do not. Or that the profession is free from flaws. Like every other group today, the medical profession has its share of errors, deficiencies, weaknesses. But these are not my subject tonight, and they do not alter two facts. That our doctors, whatever their failings, do give us the highest caliber health care in world history, and that they live a grueling existence in order to do so. I come from a medical family, and I can tell you what a doctor's life is like. Most of them study nonstop for years in medical school and then work nonstop for the rest of their life. My own father, who was a surgeon, operated daily from 7 a.m. until noon, and then made hospital rounds. From 2 to 6 p.m., he held office hours. When he came home for dinner, if he did, the phone never stopped ringing. It was nurses asking instructions, or doctors discussing emergency cases, or patients presenting symptoms. When he got the chance, usually late at night or on Sundays after rounds, he would read medical journals or write for them. to keep abreast of the latest research. My father was not an exception. This is how most doctors in any branch of medicine live and how they work. The profession imposes not only killing hours, but also continuous tension. One way or another, doctors deal all the time with crises, with accidents, diseases, trauma, disaster, the imminence of death. Even when an ailment is not a mortal threat, the patient often fears that it is, and he must be reassured, nursed through the terror, even counseled psychologically by the physician. The pressure on the doctor never lets up. If he wants to escape, even for the space of a single dinner on the town, chances are that he cannot. He will probably get beat and have to rush to the emergency room just as the entree is being served. The doctor not only has to live and work in such a pressure cooker, he has to think all the time, clearly, objectively, scientifically. Medicine is a field that requires a vast fund of specialized theoretical knowledge. To apply it properly to particular cases, the doctor must continuously make delicate, excruciatingly complex decisions. Medical treatment is not usually a cut-and-dried affair with a simple, self-evident course of action. It requires the balancing of countless variables. It requires clinical judgment. And the doctor must not only exercise such judgment, he must do it fast. Typically, he has to act now. He cannot petition the court or his client or any employer for a postponement. He faces daily, hourly, the merciless timetable of nature itself. What I personally admire most about doctors is the fact that they live this kind of life, not out of any desire for altruistic self-sacrifice, but selfishly, which is the only thing that enables them to survive it. They love the field, most of them. They find the work a fascinating challenge in applied science. They are proud men, most of them, with an earned pride in their ability to observe, evaluate, act, cure. And thank God, they expect to be rewarded materially for their skill. They want to make a good living, which is the least men can offer them in payment for their achievements. They make that living, as a rule, by standing on their own, not as cogs in some faceless government-subsidized enterprise, but as entrepreneurs in private practice. In this regard, the doctors are among the last of the capitalist breed left in this country. They are among the last of the individualists that once populated this great nation. Ladies and gentlemen, if I knew nothing about today's world but the nature of our politicians and the philosophy represented by the medical profession, I would predict an inevitable clash. A catastrophic clash between the two, between the government and the doctors. On purely theoretical grounds, I would predict the destruction of the doctors by the government, which in every field now protects and rewards the exact opposite of thought, effort, and achievement. This evening, I want to tell you that this catastrophe is actually taking place, and in what manner and how it will affect your future as well. To understand what is happening in medicine today, we must go back to the beginning, which in this case is 1965, the year when Medicare and Medicaid were finally pushed through Congress by Lyndon Johnson. Medicare, as you may know, covers most of the medical expenses of those over 65, whatever their income. Medicaid is a supplemental program for the poor of any age. Those of us who opposed the Johnson plan argued at the time that government intervention in medicine is immoral in principle and would be disastrous in practice. No man, we claimed, has a right to medical care. If he cannot pay for what he needs, then he must depend on voluntary charity. Government financing of medical expenses, we argued, even if it is for only a fraction of the population, necessarily means eventual enslavement of the doctors, and as a result, a profound deterioration in the quality of medical care for everyone, including the aged and the poor. The proponents of Medicare were unmoved by any arguments. Altruistic service to the needy, they said, is man's duty. It is degrading, they said, for the elderly to be dependent on private charity. A means test isn't compatible with human dignity. Besides, they added, the government would not dream of asking for any control over the doctors or over their methods of patient care. All we want the state to do, they said, is pay the bills. Well, it is now 1985. Let us look at what actually happened. The first result of the new program should have been self-evident. Suppose we apply the same principle to nutrition. Suppose President Johnson had said, it's unfair to have to pay for your own food and restaurant bills. Men have a right to eat. Washington, therefore, will pick up the tab. Can you project the results? Can you imagine the eating binges? The sudden mania for dining out? The soaring demand for baked peacock tongues and other gourmet delicacies? Do you see Lutece and the 21 Club becoming nationally franchised and starting to outdraw McDonald's? Why not? The eaters do not have to pay for it. And the food industry, including its most sincere members, is ecstatic. Now that the money is pouring from Washington into the grocery chains and the restaurants, they can give every customer the kind of luxury treatment once reserved for millionaires. Something the government recognized has to be done. We are going broke because of the insatiable demand for medical care. The government did not decide to cancel its programs and return to a free market in medicine. When are disastrous government programs ever canceled? Instead, it did what governments do. It decided to keep the programs but impose rigid controls on them. How? The first step was a campaign to force hospitals not to spend much on Medicare patients, no matter what the effects on the health of those patients. We will no longer, officials said, pay hospitals a fee for each service they render a Medicare patient. That method of payment, they said, simply encourages spending. Instead, we will pay according to a new principle, DRGs. Remember those letters, DRG. They represent the first major assault by the government against the doctors and their patients. It is not yet the strangulation of the medical profession, but it is the official dropping of the noose around their necks. DRG means Diagnosis Related Group. According to this approach, the government has divided all ailments into 468 possible diagnoses and has set in advance a fixed arbitrary fee for each. It will pay a hospital only what it claims is the average cost of the ailment. For example, for a Medicare patient in the Western Mountain region who is admitted to a hospital with a heart attack and finally recovers enough to go home, the government now pays the hospital exactly $5,094, no more and no less. And it pays this amount no matter what the hospital actually does for the patient. No matter how long his stay or how short, no matter how many services he requires or how few, if the patient costs the hospital more than the government payment, the hospital loses money on him. If he costs less, the hospital makes a profit. That's today's system.